I'd like to, at the outset, welcome our special guest this afternoon, who would deliver what we call the opening address to this dialogue. That's Vice Minister Chen Yan of the Ministry of Commerce of the People's Republic of China. Also with us this afternoon, and I'd like to welcome them also to the dialogue, are the ambassador to the WTO, Ambassador, I'm just thinking that I got a different list here, and I'm obviously familiar with Ambassador Yi, so I wasn't looking him at seeing him here in the list. So we have Ambassador Yi from a representative to the mission to the WTO from the from China, as well as Rufus Yerxa, who is a deputy director general of the WTO in Geneva and probably very well known to Geneva communities. So, ladies and gentlemen, Vice Minister Chen, distinguished guests, members of the Chinese business delegation who have traveled all the way here to Geneva to provide us with your expertise and be with us, engage with dialogue with all of you. It is my pleasure and honor to again to welcome you to this fourth annual Bridges China Dialogue entitled Going Global, Is China Inc. Sustainable? A bit word that I already said this morning, but I'd like to repeat. As the reality is today. Within one decade, China doubled its GDP, increased exports 4.9 times, and imports about 5 times. China's outward investment soared 60 to 70 times, from less than $1 billion in 2001 to over $60 billion in 2010. It has accumulated the world's largest foreign reserves at about $3 trillion now. China's 10-year in the WTO has happened against a backdrop of utmost dynamic change in the world economy. Indeed, China's participation in the WTO and the implications of its membership have both been a key factor of that change. China's today is essential to the WTO as much as the WTO has become essential to China. Difficulties in closing the Doha round of negotiations have to do with a multiplicity of challenges, including managing the tension brought about by change, not least transiting to a world regime on trade that fully involves players like China, other emerging economies, and their underlying shifts in growth centers and new forms of organization of production. How can Doha move onward is one of the biggest questions in town these days, and we'll hear from Rufus probably something about that. It requires effective fine-tuning It requires resolution of the adjustment turbulence currently affecting the economic and social fabric, particularly in the U.S., in Europe, and in traditional centers of growth in the West. But it will also require nimble but enabling responses from the international community to China's jugglery to rebalance development between regions and sectors, rural and urban, and the consolidation of social policies and institutions within that very complex and large country. The current economic system, with its trade policy tools, was conceived in times when the problem to be solved was of, quote, poverty in the midst of potential plenty, to quote James Mead. Back when James Mead in the 1930s came to Geneva to set up his own idea of what should be an international trade and finance system, the world looked very different. Beyond that short term, looking at demographics, trends in consumption, looking into the next 20, 30 years, the world will be entering into uncharted waters. For many of us present here, 10 years ago, to think about the kind of issues that we have in the economic reality of today would be very difficult. It would be unthinkable to, at that time, speculate that the U.S. economy or the European economy will be where they are. It will also be probably unthinkable, and people would have called you a lunatic, to try to quote the numbers that we have now gone through in terms of growth and shifts in the economic game. In China, the implementation of the 12-5-year plan launched this year may be a game changer, but it will also may be a game changer for the rest of the world. This 5-year plan has been inspired by concepts of harmony, by concepts of sustainability that were not there before, but that now seem to have been absorbed in the Chinese thinking and in that Chinese culture in a major way. Once the industrial, developmental, and environmental objectives that are set in the plan are indeed achieved by 2016, the world will probably look different and will probably benefit from those positive changes. If we continue to go on the trends that we have seen in the past 10 years, again, in 5 years, we may be looking at a very different picture. And China will be at the center of that change and of that picture. We'll have the honor to listen to Vice Minister Chen to explain China's 12-year plan in a minute, so I'm not going to get into details there. Ladies and gentlemen, a sustainable future will require robust and effective governance regimes. China's participation in crafting the evolution of the trade regime in the next 10 years will be as critical as the past 10 years have been. It is in this context that we have founded the Bridges China Dialogue. The dialogue is an independent international initiative to facilitate this cooperation between China and the world, to facilitate a constructive conversation to move forward. It is supported by research, by advisory services, and by the intellectual trust at ICTSD and the experience that we have working with thousands of stakeholders around the world every year. It is committed to improving globalization in a sustainable manner. It is committed really to harnessing the trends that we're living through to sustainability as a superior objective. So without further ado, I'd like to first invite Ambassador Yi to say a few introductory remarks. Ambassador Yi, if you'd like to take the floor. You can take it from there, yes, if you like.
Thank you, Mr. Ricardo, Mr. Melendez Ortiz, and Dear colleague Vice Minister Chen Jian, dear DDG Yuxo, and distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. Let me first express my sincere appreciation to ICTSD for inviting me to attend the fourth annual Bridges China Dialogue. It is truly a pleasure to see so many friends here today. I believe that the dialogue, as its name, Bridge, implies, will provide a good platform for Chinese academics, enterprises, and policymakers to get connected with their European counterparts. This year's Bridges China Dialogue focuses on China's going global and sustainable development, which I think is a very important topic to explore, especially against the backdrop of current international economic setting. I look forward to insightful exchanges among our distinguished guests here. This afternoon, some of you might drive Volvo cars to come here. Right now, some of you might be typing on ThinkPads. Volvo and China's Geely Automobile, IBM and China's Lenovo are among the success stories of mergers between Chinese and Western companies, in which both parties have benefited. And here in Geneva, we have the EDEX Petroleum, which became the subsidiary of Chinese Sinopec in 2009, and Bank of China Swiss SA established in 2008. Apart from their investment in developed countries, many Chinese enterprises have embraced developing nations. Take Africa as an example. By the end of 2010, China's accumulated direct investment in African countries has reached $11.3 billion. To contribute towards the development objective, China has significantly increased its investment, which covered vast areas such as infrastructure, social welfare, facilities, and agriculture. According to the report issued recently by ANCTAD, over the period 2001 to 2007, China's infrastructure finance commitment in sub-Saharan Africa increased from $470 million to $4.5 billion. It was at the beginning of China's reform and opening up in early 1980s that some Chinese enterprises started to reach out overseas and engage in outward direct investment. Encouraged by going global strategy and bolstered by the rapid growth of Chinese economy, the overseas investment of Chinese enterprises has gained great momentum in recent years. From 2000 to 2010, China's annual non-financial direct overseas investment grew from less than $1 billion to $59 billion. 13,000 Chinese invested companies are operating in 178 economies in the world. By the end of 2010, overseas China-invested companies have paid taxes worth $11.7 billion and created 780,000 jobs. We are glad to see that China's investment is welcomed both by the host countries and the international community. As UNCTAD commented in its 2011 World Investment Report, Africa's developing country partners, particularly China, are making significant contributions that could have a positive impact on the region's quest for industrialization. For the first 30 years, in terms of investment, China's opening up mainly took form of attracting FDIs and providing business opportunities to the foreign companies. But for the next decades, we hope to see more Chinese companies reach out to gain international experiences and deliver their capital, production, technologies, and employment beyond our borders. We believe that in the next 5 or 6 years, China's overseas investment is expected to reach the same level of its inbound FDI, which at present stands at around $100 billion annually. That being said, in some countries, Chinese investments have to undergo excessive scrutiny and have often been rejected on the ground of security concerns. We sincerely hope these countries could improve their investment environment and provide fair treatment to Chinese companies, which I am sure will benefit both parties. Ladies and gentlemen, as an active participant of economic globalization, China has been committed to further opening up as well as to trade and investment liberalization. This basic policy will never change. China would like to join hands with other countries to create more favorable investment environment for companies both home and abroad. At the end, I wish the fourth annual Bridges China Dialogue every success. And all guests have a good stay in Geneva. I thank you.
Thank you very much, Ambassador Yi. What I'd like to do now is then turn the floor to our keynote speaker and invite Vice Minister Chen Yan to give the opening address of the fourth Bridges China Dialogue on the topic of the 12th five-year plan and going global strategies. Would you like to take the floor from there or here, please? Here. So as you come here, let me just tell the audience that before being Vice Minister, Vice Minister Chen had experience also in the private sector, as well as bilateral relations, serving in Argentina, and has as well as with the technical cooperation arm of MOFCOM. And so it's since 2008 that he's been appointed Vice Minister, as well as the central leadership management of MOFCOM, of the Ministry of Foreign Commerce. Minister Chen, tiene la palabra. Minister Chen is fluent in Spanish.
<笑>尊敬的麦德林先生，尊敬的伊克萨副总干事，尊敬的伊小准大使，女士们、先生们、朋友们，大家好。 非常高兴出席本次日内瓦高层中国论坛。在此，我谨代表中国商务部对会议的召开表示热烈的祝贺。日内瓦高层中国论坛自创办以来，在促进世界了解中国和中国企业融入世界方面发挥日益重要的作用，已经成为以中国为主题的重要的国际论坛之一。 本次会议的主题是中国企业海外投资与可持续发展，为大家提供了一个研究国际投资发展趋势、探索加强投资合作的有效平台。借此，我想介绍一下中国的对外投资情况，并谈几点看法。近年来，中国企业对外投资合作取得了一定的发展。2010年，对外直接投资达到688亿美元。截至2010年底，对外直接投资的存量超过了3100亿美元。中国企业对外投资涉及众多领域，其中租赁和商务服务业占31%，金融业占17%，采矿业占14%。这些投资分布在全球178个国家和地区，其中70%以上是在亚洲国家和地区。对欧投资近年来呈现了快速的增长态势，2010年达到了68亿美元，同比增长102%，占当年中国对外投资额的10%，这大概这个数字。总体上看，目前中国企业对外投资合作尚处于起步阶段，我们走出去的时间还较短，还有很多需要学习和成长的地方。同时，中国投资也日益受到来自各方的关注。的确，中国快速发展可能造成一些局部的不平衡，由此也带来一些认识上的差异。对此，我们能够理解并采取包容的态度。但是，世界必将不断地发展前进，而发展就可能带来局部的失衡和必要的调整，也必将由此产生新的平衡，这是社会经济发展的规律。因此，中国需要正确认识和理解世界的关注，而世界也需要正确认识和理解中国的发展，避免因为认识上的差异阻碍我们加强合作，实现共同发展的步伐。基于上述认识，对于中国企业走出去，我谈三点意见。第一，中国的发展对世界各国企业而言是发展的机遇。作为世界第二大经济体、第二大货物进口国和第二大外国直接投资目的地，中国的经济持续稳定发展将为世界经济的稳定、复苏和持久繁荣提供重要的动力。预计未来5年，中国进口将超过80,000亿美元的商品。到2015年，中国社会消费品零售总额有望达到31亿人民币。这将为包括欧洲在内的世界各国企业提供了更多更大的发展机会。中国的发展是开放包容的发展，中国愿与世界各国分享中国经济发展的成果，支持中国企业与世界各国企业通过优势互补实现合作共赢，拓展更大的发展空间。第二，是中国企业的发展是市场作用的结果。中国企业走出去开展对外投资合作，遵循国际通行规则，不垄断、不排他，是一种市场行为。目前，中国企业走出去已经呈现百花齐放的局面，除了国有控股企业，一些非国有企业如华为、吉利汽车、三一重工等等，他们在对外投资合作领域已具有相当的实力，并在国际市场上非常活跃。目前，中国经济是市场经济，各类企业都是按照市场规律 自主经营，自负盈亏。中国企业走出去是根据企业自身条件和发展需要以及国际市场情况做出的自主选择，既有成功的经验，也有失败的教训。因此，我希望那些对中国企业，特别是国有企业投资存有疑虑的人们，摒弃不必要的思维定势，客观公正地看待中国企业的对外投资，避免非经济因素影响正常的商业活动，为企业投资合作创造良好的环境，促进双方的共同发展。第三，中国企业走出去是坚持互利共赢、共同发展的理念。中国企业在走出去过程中，始终坚持互利共赢、共同发展的理念，并取得了较好的成效。例如，通过基础设施建设合作，帮助东道国筹措了建设资金，建成了一批城市基础设施和成套生产项目，改善了当地的生产生活条件，增加了当地的就业和税收，让当地人民感受到经济发展带来的好处。根据统计，2010年当年，境外中资企业为东道国提供超过78万个就业岗位，当地纳税达到117亿美元。中国企业还积极参与当地的社会公益事业，认真履行社会责任，与当地人民和睦相处，受到了当地人民的欢迎。我相信，随着中国经济的进一步发展和改革开放进程的不断推进，中国企业走出去的步伐将会更加稳健，在推动世界经济发展方面也会发挥越来越重要的作用。女士们、先生们，当前世界经济仍然面临着严峻的挑战，影响世界经济发展的不确定因素仍然很多。为适应国内外形势的新变化，加快中国经济社会发展，中国政府制定并实施了国民经济和社会发展的第12个5年规划。未来5年，中国将以科学发展为主题，以加快转变经济发展方式为主线，大力实现扩大内需战略，努力推进区域协调发展，加快建设资源节约型、环境友好型社会，大力实施互利共赢的开放战略，着力解决发展中的不平衡、不协调、不可持续的问题，推动经济长期平稳、较快的发展和社会和谐进步。作为对外开放的重要内容，中国在12.5期间将加快实施走出去战略，鼓励有条件的企业开展对外投资合作。在投资领域上，将加强国内外的产业衔接，鼓励企业在境外开展技术研发、制造、营销网络等领域的投资合作，深化国际能源资源互利合作，帮助东道国增强发展能力，增加就业，改善民生。在投资方式上，要鼓励企业因地制宜地开展跨国并购或绿地投资，探讨融资租赁等新形式，探索投资与贸易相结合等新模式，与其他国家和地区企业联合开展对外投资，推进区域性的开发投资。在经营主体上，将支持各类所有制、各个地区、各个层次有条件的企业有序地走出去，努力培育一批具有竞争力的跨国公司，积极引导企业在当地开展公益事业，履行社会责任，与当地民众共享、共同分享中国投资的成果，注重资源节约、环境保护和人与自然的和谐。要进一步完善对外投资合作的法律体系，引导企业制定前瞻性的企业国际化发展战略和规划， 不断提高企业经营的透明度，增强防控投资风险的能力。在积极开展对外投资的同时，中国将继续鼓励外商对华投资。2010年，中国实际利用外资规模达到了1147亿美元，同比增长了22%，连续19年居发展中国家首位。中国将不断加强投资环境、软环境的建设，进一步完善市场体系，加强知识产权保护，营造公平公正的投资环境，积极创新吸引外资方式，鼓励外商通过兼并、购买等方式参与国有企业的重组改造，加大治理、人才、技术的引进工作力度，借鉴国际先进的管理经验，扩大金融、物流等服务业对外开放，鼓励外资投向高端制造、新能源和节能环保等领域。女士们、先生们，跨国投资是经济增长的重要动力，对实现世界经济复苏、增加各国就业、落实联合国千年发展目标等都具有重要的意义。我们应以更加开阔的视野、更加开放的胸怀，进一步相互开放市场，共同推动贸易投资便利化的进程，坚持坚决反对任何形式的保护主义，坚持透明非歧视的原则，避免将经济问题政治化，为国际投资创造更加稳定可预期的投资环境。我相信在一个自由开放的环境中，中国企业走出去战略的有效实施，必将进一步促进中国与东道国经济发展和社会进步，为世界经济强劲、可持续、平衡增长做出更大的贡献。最后，预祝本次日内瓦高层中国论坛取得圆满的成功，谢谢大家。
Thank you, Minister Chen. Allow me now to turn immediately to our last speaker at this session, Mr. Rufus Yerxa, Deputy Director General of the World Trade Organization. Rufus, would you like to take the floor from your place there? Yes.
Thank you very much, Ricardo, and thank you for inviting me to this important conference. I'd like to thank my friend Ambassador Yi for his remarks, and of course, very interesting remarks of Vice Minister Chen about China's economic plan and China's future trends in both trade and investment. I'm mindful of the time limit, so I don't want to speak for too long. I think I'll just make a few key points, many of which have already been stressed, and certainly they relate to the role of China in the world economy, but also the role of organizations such as mine, the WTO. You've all heard discussion here about the tremendous growth in China's trade and investment over the past 10 years. As someone responsible for the WTO budget, I mark this by their growth as a contributor to the budget, because our budget is determined by a country's share of international trade in goods, services, and intellectual property among WTO members. And since China joined in 2001, it has gone from the seventh largest contributor to our budget to the second largest contributor in just 10 years. So everyone has commented on how tremendous this growth has been, but probably what isn't as much talked about is what a momentous impact this has on decision making and the governance of the world economy. We really haven't seen anything like this, the phenomenon of China's growth since the growth of the United States as a world competitor in the 19th century. And in many ways, China's is much, much quicker and more spectacular. It does mean, of course, that the balance of power in the world economy has shifted. It's not just China, by the way. Certainly other major emerging economies like India and Brazil have helped to shift that power balance. And this means, of course, that decision-making and cooperation within the international sphere is realigned. And as is evidenced by the difficulty we're having in the Doha round, these are new relationships in many cases based on a very fundamental change in the interests and in the perspectives of the key players. While China has approached many issues in recent trade negotiations with a great deal of self-confidence, maybe you look at the economic problems and the difficulties that the United States and Europe are having in coping with such problems as their debt and their increasing unemployment, they are much less confident in negotiations than they were in the past. And this certainly creates difficulties in finding the appropriate balance of interests. China, when it acceded to the WTO, acceded on terms which meant a significant opening of its market. And it really created a sort of a new category of countries in the system, because in the old negotiations in the GATT and certainly the Uruguay round, we really had two categories of countries. We had developing and developed economies. And the kinds of commitments undertaken by the developed countries were more significant, deeper cuts in tariffs, for example, whereas developing countries were to a large extent left out of those negotiations. Many products of interest to them weren't negotiated, and they were not asked to make as many commitments. So we really sort of had a two-tier system. Now, with China's entry into the WTO, it really became a third category, somewhere in between the levels of commitments of other developing countries and the developed world. And this now has created expectations, particularly on the part of the developed countries, for the emerging countries to move more towards a greater openness. At the same time, there is an expectation on the part of many of the developing countries that the developed world will move in areas of traditional protection like agriculture. And China, as it emerges as a major player in the process, finds itself in the middle of a lot of this shifting of power, but also shifting of interests in the trading system. And while we haven't really found the solution to that yet, compromise has been very difficult to reach. I want to emphasize at this conference the importance both to China and to China's competitors of having a successful and smooth functioning international governance system, including a strong WTO with renewed commitment from its key members. I would not like to think of how much more difficult it would have been for China's emergence to have occurred in an atmosphere where there were no trade rules and there were no real strong commitments. In other words, the decision to bring China into the WTO was the right decision, both for China and for the rest of the world. It not only helped to provide a foundation for economic reforms in China, but also for China to participate in the trading system in a rules-based fashion. And so as we move forward to a different kind of parity in the trading system, if we make the mistake of diminishing the importance of institutions like the WTO, if we fail to strengthen it and to find a path forward for overcoming the current differences, I think that we will find ourselves in a much more difficult and chaotic environment, not just for trade, but for investment as well. And you know, there's an old saying, if you don't know where you're going, you probably won't get there. And that certainly, I think, applies to the current debate over where to take the WTO. It's important for the major members to begin to overcome their differences. I would cite first the importance of the bilateral relationship between the two largest players, which right now has a lot of tension and friction in it, but which needs to be more secure, and that is the U.S.-China relationship, but also the relationship among all of the major players in the trading system. We sometimes talk about the big five players in the Doha negotiations, the Europeans, the Chinese, Indians, Brazilians, and the U.S. Certainly, the G20 plays an important role in finding new solutions. And so while I don't have any good news to bring you about significant breakthroughs in the Doha round, I want to use this conference to emphasize the importance for China, but also the importance for the rest of the world of making sure we overcome our differences and strengthen institutions like the WTO if we're going to continue to see a stable economic growth and development around the world. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Rufus. I think in a way, if I may add that word, China's record in the WTO and the significance of its membership to the WTO to a great extent highlight how much the WTO is more than the Doha round of negotiations and how much the stability and the resilience of that system it's important to the world. So I have promised the audience that we would entertain questions to Minister Chen. Allow me then to open the floor to maybe two or three questions, if I may. So if you can just sign up if you're interested in asking a question, and then when you do so, indicate your name and affiliation. Anybody who'd like to ask Minister Chen for questions? So I have Jean-Pierre and Daniel on that side. Anybody on this side, just so that I can see? Okay, so for the moment.
Thank you very much, Jean-Pierre Lehmann, Evian Group at IMD. Question to the minister. In view of China's overseas investment and this being the going global strategy, what implications could this have in terms of the yuan? And would it not make much more sense to acquire companies and invest overseas to have a stronger yuan?
So let me take the other question first before I go back to you. Daniel?
Yes, Vice Minister Daniel Prusin, Geneva correspondent with BNA in Washington. In light of the faltering Doha talks, I'm wondering what China is thinking in regards to reorienting its trade policy, in particular, under what conditions, if any, China would consider taking part in the Trans-Pacific Partnership negotiations? Thank you.
Thank you. So let's take these two questions for the moment. Minister Chen?
TPP, that's what you answer. You answer, okay? I'll answer the question about the currency. You have a translation? 有翻译了吧？对，再翻。这个中国的开放是全方位的开放，当然包括货币也是开放。这个货币开放呢，中国现在允许人民币进行跨境的结算，同时呢，允许人民币进行海外的直接投资。那么人民币这个哪个地方能够接受人民币？ 我想中国政府没有刻意一定要在全球推行自己的人民币，只要这个市场需要，我们就会积极的回应这个市场的需要。至于说人民币的坚挺强硬作为中国海外投资整个对外开放的一个基础的话，我想中国的经济就是人民币的基础。谢谢。
Well, thank you very much for the question. It's interesting that now we are facing the difficulties in Doha, but some people are talking about the TPP. As far as China is concerned, we welcome any regional or bilateral arrangements as long as they are facilitating the trade and investment, and they are strengthening the multilateral trading system. And specifically on TPP, China is open on that regional arrangement, and we are watching the progress on TPP, and we are interested in whether the TPP is open to China, whether they welcome China to have a more deeply or deeper discussions with the participants of TPP to strengthen China's trade and investment relations with those countries. So we don't have any objection to TPP, but meanwhile, we hope it will not deviate the multilateralism, or it will not damage the multilateral trading system. So we are waiting and see whether in the future there's a possibility that China can be involved in that discussion. Thank you.
Thank you both, Mr. Chin and Ambassador Yi. I then said I would take one more question, but let's take, if I know that it's a great interest to have you in town. So let me take these three questions here on this side. So let me suggest you take, you take you first, then Gary, and then in the back.
Chen Buzhang, Wu Changqi, Beijing University. 陈部长，我这样一个问题，就是中国对外的直接投资啊，从现在从总量上来看，在这个亚太区，还有这个拉美和非洲比较多，啊，因为中国企业呢也在，比如说在美国啊，在欧洲啊，做一些投资，但这些好像是，不是特别，有些不特别顺利，我就不知道在这方面这个从总体上来讲，这个中国企业在这个欧洲，比如像华为在欧洲的收购啊，或者其他地方，这些哪些地方这个。 作为这个欧洲或者是美国的这些政府或组织，能不能做些什么，感觉到能够推动中国在这个欧洲，比如讲是吧，这个地方的直接投资的这样的活动，请教一下。Let
me go immediately to Gary now.
Thanks, Gary Elfbauer with the Peterson Institute. As everyone here knows, the Doha Round has troubles, but many people are already talking about what should be done after Doha, what should be on the agenda after Doha. And so I'd like to specifically ask Minister Chen and Ambassador Yi what their view is of, let's say, two or three subjects which the WTO should take up after Doha, and very specifically, whether the WTO should engage in the investment issues.
Thank you, Gary. Yes, let's take both John and go ahead.
Okay, I'm from Brazil. My name is Jamil Chade. Mm-hmm. We have a. You have spoken about problems of getting access to some of the markets. But what we've seen is that not only Chinese companies have problems in developed world, but now they're facing some trouble also in developing countries. For example, in my own country, the minister of the government has announced barriers against Chinese cars, for example, higher tariffs. What is your message to, for example, in the case of the Brazilian government that actually puts these barriers against your cars, when actually at the same time talks politically about the BRICS, for example.
Okay, John, just very briefly.
Yes, good afternoon. John Zarakostas with the Condé Nast publications in New York. Vice Minister, you mentioned that you're going to dramatically increase retail sales in China in the next few years. Do you have any projections on how much consumption will increase as a percentage of China's GDP. Right now it's around 37% compared with 70% for the US. And how long will it take for China to go up the consumption scale? Is it a 20-year step-by-step plan or fast-tracking it? And secondly, the IMF says that you're going to be holding around $7 trillion in Forex in 3 years' time. Is that good for rebalancing the world economy? Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you all. Those are four excellent questions and on very different subjects. Let me turn to Minister Chen.
我对提出来的问题分别做一点回应。第一个问题啊，关于中国对外投资是不是在区域上啊，有一些碰到了一些障碍。目前中国的对外投资主要，我刚刚已经讲了 70% 在亚洲地区，那么欧西欧和北美地区的投资相对来说比较少，这是我刚刚讲的。 第二个我讲到了对西欧的投资，欧洲的投资去年有了个突然的高增长，也就增长 102% 那么为什么会出现这样一些现象呢？我认为主要是中国企业对欧洲市场的熟悉有一个过程，他们首先比较熟悉亚洲市场、非洲市场。 以及拉美市场，那么现在开始熟悉欧洲市场，就开始对欧洲市场的投资大量的增加。我也注意到，这个去年，中国对美国的投资也有个很高的增长，这是也许由于当前的形势所决定的。至于说是不是有些国家对投资 实施了保护主义或者反政治化的倾向问题，我想不愿意具体来指这些问题。现在存在贸易投资保护主义的问题，贸易投资保护主义只能有害于他这个国家。最后，在经济全球化的今天，他可以保护，外国投资不进去就是了。等到他发现投资没有的时候， 他自然会把门开放。那么当前我看总体，我这次来主要到欧洲来访问，考察中国在欧洲的投资以及欧洲在华的投资。从这个角度上讲，我今天上午跟苏瓦布先生也交流了这样的看法。我认为啊，现在中欧企业的感受面对这样一个形势的感受是同样的，他们的感受就是兴奋。 加上不安，兴奋是由于大量的赚钱了，包括欧洲企业在中国都赚钱了，中国企业在欧洲也赚钱了，但是他们由于对这些国家的情况呢，还缺乏了解，所以程度不同，有些不安。那么解决这些问题，我想要通过一个过程，相互在文化层面，今天上午我们讲到的 四句话：第一要沟通，第二要理解，第三要包容，第四要相互欣赏。这样，我想这种融合这些问题就不再存在了。至于说政府层面采取的一些政策，我想不是太大的问题，可以通过多哈回合谈判继续去解决去，是吧？这是我想第一个问题。第二个问题呢？ 我先回答，就是内需的问题。中国已经确定了积极促进内需的方针，未来大概国内消费品零售总额达到31亿元人民币。那么，中国拉动内需这样一个政策的实施，政府态度是坚定的。那么，实施起来的效果 一定是有一个过程的，是有个过程的，因为从一个外需为主，逐步是外需内需并重，又以内需为主这样一个政策的转变呢，它是一个过程，但是我预期这个政策会很顺利的实施起来，所以可以预见，中国 进口量希望这个欧洲的企业家们关注，一个是中国的进口量将加大，另外一个中国的内需市场将加大，这给欧洲企业提供了一个很好的发展契机。巴西提出来的问题是关于政府的保护主义问题，我刚刚讲了，我不愿意评论这个问题。至于说巴西政府采取的措施是不是保护主义，您可以做一个评论。我也讲了这个道理，你可以保护，保护的结果别人不去就是了，最后是你发展不起来，对吧？所以我们是坚持要反对各种形式的贸易保护主义，不仅仅是从中国的利益出发的，我们是维护世界多边贸易体制，为全球各国利益出发，提出来反对各种贸易保护主义。在经济全球化的今天，任何一个封闭的经济体必然得不到发展，它必然不能共享世界发展的这样一个大的趋势和这种发展的红利，它必定断然是享受不到的。所以你做完评论之后，你跟巴西政府说去。刚刚那个教授提到说多哈回合以后，这个问题应该易大使来回答，但我想到了一个课题，多哈回合以后谈什么？我看就你那个机构的名称就好，就谈可持续发展，在中国说来就叫谈科学发展观。谢谢。
I think now people are discussing that issue about post-Doha. I think we are going to address a lot of new issues or so-called 21st century issues, such as food security, such as climate change, energy, as you mentioned, investment. But meanwhile, we all know that the starting point should be that we can address the old issues. I mean, we cannot forget development issues. We cannot forget LDC issues. So as long as we can address those old issues, then we are ready to start those new issues. So I think that's the reality here in Doha talks. Thank you.
Well, thank you again, Ambassador Yi, Rufus Yerxa, and Minister Chen, for an excellent panel. As everybody here in this room knows, if we continue on the tone of these questions, we would probably take the whole afternoon, and it would be fun. But our colleagues had scheduled a different type of program, and we're eating into their time. So let me, with this, just ask you to join me in congratulating the panel on their views and thanking them for their views, and then just turning the floor to Deborah for guidance on what happens next. So thank you again very much.